This is what happens if I miss my Claritin 2 days
in a row.
Guess that tells me whether it was working. I'll just try to keep all my private germs to myself.
Amen.
They're mine.
Don't share. This one goes all the way back to, I don't know what you call it, I guess charismatic days. My spiritual youth. Used to do a lot of meetings, meetings for Full Gospel Businessmen back in the, how many remember that organization? That's like split six ways from Sunday when the founder passed away. And anyway, we had a lot of fun. They used to sing this song quite a bit. Elaine, who's not here, her dad used to sing this song, and he was part of those meetings. And boy, just so many memories. Music does that, doesn't it? If you're driving along, listen to the radio, you listen to hear a song, take you back to college, you know, your foolish youth. Yeah, songs are like that. But they can bless us spiritually too, amen? And that's where we really appreciate things, when the glory of God is made manifest in your life because of a song. Let's stand together. You've got to take deep breaths when you sing this one, because it's a little on the fast side. Yes, praise God, Jesus. Hallelujah. Yeah, don't forget to breathe on this one. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise you, Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Jesus.
Praise the Lord.
Praise you, Yahweh.
Praise the Lord.
Praise you, Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah. Give him a clap offering this morning. We welcome you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. You're enthroned upon the praises of your people. Glory to God.
Let the whole world know, let the whole world know, let the whole world know. residence there. That the King is in residence there. That the King is in residence there.
Glory to the Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You know,
hallelujah.
Love you, Jesus.
In the old days when kings lived in castles,
you're not playing
enough. Anytime the king was in the castle, they would put the flag up, right? You know where this song comes from. And then when the king would leave, they would take the flag down if he was off somewhere. And when he came back, they would put it back up. So if the king is living in your heart, let those flags fly so everyone can tell he's there. Praise the Lord. Should seem different than other people. Somebody different is living inside you than inside the rest of the world.
Praise the Lord. From the archives to the current, amen. Back and forth.
I want to see you. I want to
want to see you too, says the Lord, for a day in my courts is better than a lifetime anywhere else. And a day for me is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is like one day. And the calendar pages are being turned over one by one by one, but they are speeding forth now. The hourglass has been tipped, and the sand is fast running out. If you long to see me, I long to see you, says the Lord, face to face, eye to eye, just as with my servant Moses. And when you finally see me face to face, as I come from heaven, as I come within a mile of planet Earth, that look will transform you quicker than you can blink your eye, says the Lord. And your body will suddenly become like mine, immune to death, immune to sickness, disease, and infirmity. You will be transferred from the terrestrial to the celestial in the flash of a moment, in the split of a split of a split second. And you and I will rule and reign together forever. Thank you, Jesus.
Many years ago, there was a young woman in the church who was so cool and so tough. And I wasn't really even sure whether she was just attending with her family or whether she actually knew the Lord. But when the word holy would come up, she would inspire me to remember and to testify about what that word means. God's holiness is not insipidness. It's not meekness. It's not, you know, like, oh, I'm so holy. It's powerful and cleansing like fire or like bleach. That's God's holiness. That's why people that don't have the blood of Jesus covering them can't come into his presence, because it would just burn them all up. And I thank God that we who have it, the blood of Jesus, and have Jesus living in our hearts, we can do that. His holiness, we can celebrate it instead of being afraid of it. But remember that when you hear the word holy, it doesn't mean what you might have been taught as a child. I know in the denomination where I was raised, it meant, you know, walk around real quiet, don't bother anybody. God's holiness is a consuming fire.
He set apart, amen.
Christmas will stand forever as the stars
the Lord for getting me here today. I've been battling heartburn. It's been keeping me up, and last night I had a good night. Praise God. I laid hands on myself again. I had forgotten to do that. And I asked the elders of the church to pray for me, like the Bible says we're supposed to do. But what really blesses me, for some reason, when I hear that song, I'm transported to Australia. Did we hear it there first?
From Australia.
Ah, that must be it. And even though that was 30 years ago, I remember it so well. It's probably getting closer to 40 years ago at this point. And I look back also to our early days that the pastor was talking about, the early days of the charismatic movement, when we would have little tiny house groups and there'd be just a few people sitting around the table, and Joe would speak to them out of the Bible. Sometimes we'd sing, but you know, the Bible reading, one of the recent times I did make it to church, was about how God has chosen the foolish things, and not many wise are called, not many great in God's eyes, and things that are not, and I like the old spelling, N-A-U-G-H-T, that means pretty much they amount to nothing, but he's chosen those things to put to shame, the things that seem to be really big and important and smart and flashy. And just remember that even like a life like Jesus, who had no internet, he stayed in his area. How great an effect he had, and how, even though our beginnings were small, we may go through phases where it seems like not much is happening. In the Spirit, he's chosen us. And in the Spirit, when we get to heaven, we're going to find out how much influence we really had. Every one of you. Every one of us. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Thanks, Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
He'll take you and he'll take us just like he took the loaves and fishes. Amen. And make something really big out of something small. Thank you, Lord.
Anything he touches multiplies. Praise the Lord. Thanks for your wonderful word. Thanks for talking to us today, Lord. Appreciate prophetic words and testimonies. They're few and far between in this Latter-day Church, but we love you, Lord. You're still alive and well and speaking when people want to hear. When people are willing to be your voice and your hand extended. Open the word to our heart this morning, Lord. Show us something we've never seen. Help us to see ourselves in a way we've never seen ourselves. Minister to us from your grace, Lord, and make us channels of blessing to someone else. In Jesus' name, amen. Have a seat.
for coming out, folks. Amen. Praise the Lord Jesus. We are starting a new series on Wednesday, Miracle Money. Anybody need any? I'm in the wrong church. All right. I won't be here this week. I'll be teaching this somewhere. Going to become a new book, kind of a renewed book, a revised book. Anyway, we'll start that on Wednesday, 7:15. We're here till about 8. So if you can make it, that would be great. If you want to volunteer for anything, please do. And let us know what you'd like to do. On the back of this little directory booklet, we have kind of who does what. And so if you see somebody that's doing something you want to do, you can just talk to them, say, how's that work? I'd like to see some lady communion server sometime. That would be nice. Someone actually asked me about that. Is that like just a man thing? I said, no. We just don't have any ladies volunteering, but we're open to that. I had a lady years ago in this fellowship that she came for quite a while, and then she kind of got a little sour, and I didn't know what it was about. But anyway, long story short, she talked to me privately. She got me told, you know, that I was... She didn't appreciate that I didn't approve of women preachers. And I'm thinking, did you see my book in the bookcase? You know, why not women? I mean, I thought she was kidding. I really thought she was kidding. And what she meant was, I wouldn't have her teach here. That's what she really meant. How many are following with me? I can't tell you how many prophets have told me that I'm cursed, the church is cursed, and this and that, because I won't receive their ministry. I don't receive prophetic ministry. I'm thinking to myself, I've received prophetic ministry, but not yours. And then you search them out, you find out they've left a trail of destruction every church they've ever been in. You know, how many following with me? Yeah. So I'm all for lady preachers. I wrote a book on it. And we had women preachers here. We used to have a lady regularly reading the scripture. I'm all for it. I'm just saying, people see what they want to see. And they'll find any excuse to get you told, you know, if they've got something in their heart that shouldn't be there. Wouldn't it be easier to just get healed? Hey, Lord, I'm angry. I'm whatever, you know. I don't want to be this way anymore. This isn't your best. I read in your word, anger is an open door to the enemy. I don't want that anymore. And let it go. But no, some people just keep on keeping on. And one fella came in when we were in the White Oak Center. Another prophet. He was supposed to go on a mission trip with me. The Lord told him he was going on a mission trip, you know. And I said, well, Lord didn't tell me anything about it. He said, well, you don't understand. The Lord told me to go. I said, well, maybe, but he didn't tell me. I said, when are you going? He said, when you're going now. I said, well, that's really interesting, because I just called the people that I'm going with. They don't even have a room for me. They don't know where they're going to put me, let alone someone else. I said, the Lord didn't get the memo. Man, he turned every color of the rainbow, stood up, pointed his little bony finger at me, called me everything but Father Christmas. I curse this place. This will be gone in 3 months for not receiving my ministry. Yeah. I was fixing to defend myself. I didn't know what he was going to do. Then he walked out. Didn't see him. Well, needless to say, we're still here 25 years after that. And we've been in two different places since. And then I got a phone call, and then I got a little note and a check from him that I'm the best thing since sliced bread 25 years later. Boy, I sure hope everything's great. I can't tell you what your ministry meant to me. You're thinking, you can't make this up. This is all free. This is not the message. Boy, you get some strange experiences in ministry, you know? I was thinking about the other day. I've been working 50 years, 7 years in secular stuff, about 30 different idiotic jobs. And then 43 years this fall, 44 this fall in the ministry. You learn stuff by accident in all that time, you know? You'll learn something just by accident, by being exposed to idiots all that time, you know? I'm sorry, but Jesus called Herod a fox. He called the religious leaders vipers, you know. It is what it is, right? That's why, like the one preacher says, be what you is and not what you ain't. Because if you ain't what you is what you ain't, you know. Be the real deal if you're the real deal. And don't let anybody change you, you know. And if you're not, guess what? People will find out. Anywho, that's a long way from Miracle Money, but we'll be here Wednesday night. First lesson, silver and gold. Silver and gold. We do need volunteers. If you miss a class, miss a service, you can always download it, watch it on Facebook or YouTube, or order a CD. And you see, we were about half our budget on last week, so God worked it out. That was my testimony if you weren't here. If you weren't here Wednesday or Sunday last, got a nice testimony from Africa, forget which country. And this fellow wants to take our courses and not only teach them, but he wants to interpret them for the people in his congregation that don't speak English. How cool is that? So it'd be like a mission trip, you know? I thought that is so neat. So good things are happening. And we're up now to 165 countries. You got your Bible with you? Let's turn to Titus. Paul's letter to Titus. Wrote this from prison. If you ever feel like you're being hindered in ministry, I don't know about you, but Paul helps me. Can't you imagine him in prison? I wish you'd use me better, Lord. Gosh, if I could just get out of this joint, you know? Go out and preach and lay hands on the sick and cast out devils. Get some prayer cloth sent. Man, I could do so much more. Why do you have me here? How many of you know he wrote a couple of letters that we find pretty interesting 2,000 years later? Can you imagine having the royalties on Titus? If you had the royalty on the letter to Titus, how many copies of the Bible are there? My goodness gracious. Hey, Paul, guess what? You did more in that jail cell writing those couple of letters than you might have done knocking yourself out preaching. Wow. All you did was miss a few more stonings, a few more prisons. One preacher said when he came to town, he didn't ask what hotel he was staying in like evangelist today. He just said, what prison am I in this time, you know? Wow. God bless him, amen. I want to meet him, hug his neck. Titus, let's go to chapter 3 this morning, and we're thinking about the question, what on earth are we doing? What on earth are we doing? Titus chapter 3, we'll pick up the reading in verse 4. We'll look at the others, but we're going to pick it up at verse 4. But after that, the kindness and love of God our Savior toward man appeared, not through works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his own mercy he saved us, by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost, whom he shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ our Savior, that being justified by his grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. This is a faithful saying, and these things I will that you affirm constantly, that they which have believed in God might be careful to maintain good works. These things are good and profitable unto all men. I had an unusual dream a couple of weeks ago. In the dream, I'm approaching a very large church and denominational of some kind, wasn't full gospel. And there was quite a large crowd of cars, and I thought it was odd because it wasn't a service day. And I thought there must be something going on special there because there's never that kind of a crowd on an off night like this. And it was off in the distance. And I look out the window, and there's a young guy that I had known because of his parents. I knew his parents and knew him to say hi to him. Didn't really know him. Knew his parents, and he's waving at me. And I'm waiting here in the traffic because of all these cars, you know, the church off in the distance, the lot's full, and all these cars trying to get in. And I rolled the window down. He said, hey, how are you? I said, good, good, good. How are you doing? He said, could you help me? I need to get into the church, and I need a ride. I said, no hassles. Hop right in. I said, might be a little late. So I can show you the back way in because I know this church. I said, well, I know you do. You know, my family's been here for years. I said, yeah, I know. So long story short, we go around a different way, and sure enough, he got me into the lot, and we're on our way into the church. And I said, what's going on? And I noticed some one sheets of a movie that were in little placards here, there, and everywhere. And it was something like zombies or Christian zombies, you know. And I thought, what? And I said, hey, what's up with this? He said, oh, this is where I'm going. He said, I'm part of the youth group. I'm kind of a leader. He said, we're screening a film today. Oh, it's all right. It's PG. It's okay. But it's about zombies, you know. I said, oh. He said, you want to come? I said, well, I hadn't really thought about it. I'm not so much into zombie movies, but, you know. Oh, you need to come. He said, come on in. So I went in the vestibule of the church, and everybody's, you know, sucking down popcorn and the soft drinks, and they're fixing to start the movie in a little bit and give me a little handout about the film and who made it and this and that. Sure enough, it's a fair dinkum horror movie, you know, with zombies and this and that. And he said, but it's got kind of a message in there a little bit, and you know, there's nothing really offensive in it. And then this lady makes a beeline for me. And I said, hello. And she said, how are you? Like she knew me. I said, fine. And she shakes my hand. She said, are you staying for the film? And I said, I have made up my mind. I just drove my friend here. She wouldn't let go of my hand, you know. I'm looking at my hand. Why don't you come in? Real provocative, you know. And I'm thinking, what's up with this? She said, why don't you watch it? Come in. You try it. You'll like it. And she's still holding my hand. And I'm thinking, no, I won't. Get me out of here. Lord, let it be a one-person rapture. I'm ready, you know. And I woke up. And as I thought about it and prayed about it and talked to Solomon about it, he's very good with dreams, by the way, if you're having trouble, I realized what God was telling me. This church that I knew was not full gospel and was not necessarily preaching the truth was actually ministering about the walking dead, to the walking dead, and they were being very seductive about it. They were trying to seduce people to come in and watch something that is PG, it's okay. And but there's a message in there somewhere, if you'll stay for the whole thing. It's how many with me? But it's dead. And what they're proclaiming, what they're showing is dead. Zombies look alive, but they're not. They're dead. The church is dead. The fellowship was dead. The outreach was dead. And if that's not enough, they've got people that are being very seductive, trying anything they can do to get you, to get me, to get anybody to get involved, to leave the truth and get involved in error. Because after all, look at the crowd. Look at the building. Look at the parking lot. You had to come around a sideway to even get in, and you needed to know somebody. Boy, that'll preach, won't it? Let's take the offering, Solomon. It's over. So how does that fit with Scripture? I think this is a really beautiful way to examine this current concept, and there are many like that, church. We're dealing basically with what I would call the need to put the horse before the cart. We've got to change our way of looking at Christianity. When I say we, I mean the organized body of the Lord, the churchianity we see today. That church had the cart before the horse. We need to turn that around and get the horse before the cart. Amen. We need to get our ducks in a row as believers, as ministers, as the body of Christ. So we want to look at the end first. Look at verse 8 in our text, Titus 3. Look at the last verse I read. We're going to start with the end, because this is where it's at, putting the horse where he belongs, before the cart, not behind. It reads actually like this: faithful, the word. The emphasis is on faithful, trustworthy, pistis. Faithful, the teaching. And these things, there it is again. Solomon mentioned Wednesday night when he was teaching, I'm the demonstrative pronoun detective. And if I see one, I circle it. A demonstrative pronoun is a pronoun that a writer adds that doesn't need to be there to communicate truth, but when it's added, it's for emphasis. He tells Titus, Paul does, these things as opposed to many other things you could teach and preach and make popular. These things I desire you to be strongly affirming in order that the ones having believed in God may take care to be devoted to good works. We start at the end. Why? Here's the meaning of the dream. We've got to put the horse before the cart, not the reverse. Why? Because people like the lady, like the guy, like the mob in that church in my dream who try to work for the Lord before they know the Lord are disqualified in the courts of heaven. People that don't know Christ, that have not received the nature of God, eternal life, that have never made him Lord, who try to do Christian things or bring unsaved people into the body of Christ are zombies, and all they're bringing in are other zombies. They look like they're alive, they smell right, look right, seem right, but they're not right. They're wrong. And their message is counterfeit. Why? Because they've got the idea that if I do enough Christian things and try to help people in the right way, then maybe someday when I get before the judgment seat of Christ, I'll get the amen from the Lord and he'll say, come, all things are now ready. The good works that they do, however, don't count because their good works are dead because they're dead spiritually. They're spiritual zombies. Yeah. Paul told the Hebrew believers that they had been purged from dead works through the blood of Christ. What is a dead work? It's some kind of a good deed that I do as an unsaved person with the attitude in mind that if I do this, that, and the other, then I'll receive eternal life as a reward, as a payback. Do you have any idea how many people who name the name of Christ live that way? And their eternal life and their salvation is off in the distance somewhere, and they're on their way to it. And they're working their way there, and they're never quite sure if they're closer or farther than they were when they began. How sad is that? The truth of the reverse of this, which Paul tells Titus, it's not the unbelievers trying to become believers that should be doing good works. It's the ones having believed in God should be preparing themselves to be devoted to good works. Why? Their works are alive because they're alive spiritually. They're kin to God through Christ. They share his eternal life. So the Spirit motivating them is not the prince of the power of the air, the Spirit now working in the sons of disobedience. It's not that. It's the Spirit of Christ. It's the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit. What a difference. What a difference to be motivated by the Holy Spirit. This is the truth Martin Luther rediscovered. This is what we celebrated the whole last quarter of last year on the 500th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation. Dr. Luther, in reading the Epistle to the Romans, discovered the just shall live by faith. Oh, I receive life from God as a free gift. It's all good between me and God. No longer a road with eternal life and salvation off in the distance. Maybe I'll get there, maybe I won't. In the meantime, I better get ready and get as many people into the church as I possibly can by any means necessary, even if I have to seduce them a little. How sad. Luther rediscovered the truth. We don't work our way into the blessings of God. They're a gift. And now that it's all good between me and God, Luther says, now ask yourself, what can I do to be of service to my fellow man for the rest of my life? Now that it's all good between me and God and I don't have to do things to please him, I'm not involved in dead works by a dead person, but I'm a living person, a true Christian. I'm no longer somebody eating spaghetti by the pound in the hope of eventually becoming Italian. I'm an Italian who just eats spaghetti. Tracking with me? I'm no longer sleeping in the garage overnight every night, hoping against hope. If I do it long enough, I'll eventually become a car. Boy, it's quiet in here. This is the Christianity too many people still have today. Their salvation and their life in God is postponed. And any good works they do are not good in God's eyes because they're done by zombies, two zombies. Not only has something wonderful happened in our present because we've already believed God, but there's something for us in the future. Look at it. Look at verse 7. In order that, having been justified by the grace, that one, we'll look at it. We should become for ourselves heirs according to the hope of life, eternal in quality. Think about this. Our believing God in the present has impacted our present, hasn't it? It enables us to minister to other people out of an overflow. Hello, Rosemary. How are you doing today? Did you get my new book? And I give him my new book. Not so that God will smile at me and finally accept me. See what a good thing I did? See what I did? I gave away a book. How cool is that? Am I up another notch? No, it's already good between me and God. I don't have to do anything. But hey, you know what? This isn't bad if I say so myself. Give her the free book, right? You see the difference? Oh, what a wonderful way to live. What a wonderful way to live. It enables us to minister in the present to others out of an overflow because we're already taken care of It's all good with us and God. And if that was not enough, think about this, folks. Because you and I have RSVP'd God's invitation of grace, come unto me and I'll rest you. Believe in me and you'll have eternal life. Because we RSVP'd, we didn't just take care of ourselves in the natural, but we are taking care of ourselves in the future. We're heirs of eternal life. Again, many believers today are confused about this. Well, wait a minute. You're back to where you started. Maybe my new life in Christ is off in the distance somewhere. It says I'm an heir of it. I don't have it yet. Depends on what you're talking about. Paul's talking about eternal life for our body. Amen? Just like he did in Romans 8. How many have eternal life in your body? Please don't raise your hand. You know what I'm going to say, don't you? If you got it, if that's eternal life in your body, I want a refund. No, we don't. In Romans 8, Paul says, our spirit is alive because of righteousness right now, but our body is what? Dead, but not forever. We've got a new body. Did you like that prophetic word this morning? One of several. Wasn't that something? How we're going to get a body like Christ quicker than you can blink your eye. It was a reminder when Jesus returns, that eternal life that's presently in our spirit man only is going to flash forth and touch our bodies. And our body's going to match him. He's the firstborn among many brethren. You and I are going to be conformed to his outer image. We're going to look just like him. That's not talking about his inner character. It's talking about his physical person. It's not something we do gradually, like our daily walk in Christ, where we get a little bit more like him every day. No, this is going to happen, boom, like that in a second, less than a second. We're going to look just like him physically. How beautiful is that? We've made ourselves heirs of eternal life for our body because we are RSVP'd. We said, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. Did you notice how my paraphrase there? In order that having been declared righteous in right standing with God by grace, we should become for ourselves heirs in the hope of eternal life for our body. Kind of strange, isn't it? Why did I paraphrase it like that? Because it's written in the middle voice, which means we don't have a middle voice in English. We just have active and passive. There's a middle voice in Greek, which means you personally participate in whatever's going on, usually in your own best interest. And I think this is so cool because how many of you know you don't choose to be in somebody's will? You can't choose to be in someone's will, can you? And you might be ignorant enough to ask, but I mean, you really can't. The person decides who's in his will. Do you know two different people that I'm aware of currently have put the church in their will? Yeah, for the first time in 30 years that I'm aware of, people put our church in their will. We didn't ask, of course, you can't. But they did it. Isn't that neat? We had one person who had put us in their will, and the family changed the will. Sad, isn't it? They changed the will, and then money went somewhere else. But think about this. According to this scripture, we ask to be in Christ's will. We choose, we decide whether we're going to be in his will, whether we're going to get a new body or not. How cool is that? You say, well, wait a minute, Pastor. What about the elect? It's only God's chosen. It's only his elect that are going to get the new body, just like it's only the elect that are going to receive salvation. Yes, I know that, but we don't know who they are, do we? We don't know who the elect are. We don't know who the chosen are. Only God does. They're elect. They're chosen according to his foreknowledge. But you and I don't have that, do we? That's why we preach the gospel to everybody. But guess what? God makes sure that his elect hear the gospel because he knows when they hear it, they're going to believe and become part of his family, right? So from this point of view, we don't know whether we're elect or not, but here's the good news. We can choose to be from our point of view. We can choose to be believers. We can choose to put ourselves in God's will. How cool is that? Sign me up. Big, long will. Bunch of names. Hey, wait a minute. How do I get in on this? It's going to cost you everything. It's going to cost you your life. You're going to have to make Jesus Lord of your life. You're going to have to get off the throne of your heart and put Jesus there. If you make that transaction, we'll put your name in the will. And then after you do that, when you get to heaven, elect according to the foreknowledge of God. Oh, man, I was chosen after all. Of course you were. That's why you responded. Good preaching, isn't it? Pass the offering plate, Solomon, while they're hot. No, I'm get them while they're in a frenzy. No, I'm kidding. We have to wait for the Jewish feast because that's when you get the 13 times you're getting. Oh, God help us. Let's move along. So the horse before the cart, and now we're getting into this concept of what are we doing? What on earth are we doing right now? Paul alludes to some grace that made all this possible, that made it right between us and God so we could devote ourselves to good works, not because we have to, but because we get to. It's his grace that allowed us to read ourselves into the will so that we'll have eternal life for our body when Jesus returns. What kind of grace in it is this that has done so much for us? Let's go back now to our earlier verses. Here's one I didn't read. Titus 3:3. You probably don't want me to, do you? You don't want me to read this, do you? For we ourselves also were sometimes foolish. Anybody here foolish? Disobedient. What's that mean? Yeah, it means disobedient, basically to the faith. It means you heard about Christ, you said no thanks, repeatedly, many of us. Disobedient to the faith, deceived, serving different kinds of lusts and desires, living in malice and envy, hateful, and hating one another. That's what you were. That's what I was. That's what everyone was. That verse explains what's going on in the world today. That's the source of all the human problems. Because people that have not made Jesus Lord and don't have eternal life and don't have the Holy Spirit motivating them, according to Ephesians 2, are being moved about on planet Earth according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, that's Satan, the spirit constantly working in the sons of disobedience. Want a freebie? Want a freebie? Same word, disobedience. There's an article before it. The sons of the disobedience. It means a particular kind of unbelief, a particular kind of sin. It's unbelief toward Christ. Search the scriptures if you have access to the original text. You'll see this over and over again. Often there's an article before this word belief or faith. And it's talking about a particular kind of unbelief, a particular kind of disobedience. It means not making Jesus Lord. That is the be-all and end-all in God's mind. Why? Because he's in love with his son. He loves him so much he wants to keep on replicating him over and over and over and over. My little pug dog, Peanuts, lived to be almost 15. I wish I could have cloned him. I just imagine a whole house full of Peanuts. Every room. How you doing? You sad? Just imagine every room. I got a little cat now. I'm not sure about cloning him. Boy, he's bad. Man, he's bad. He finds stuff to get into you just can't even imagine. But my other cat, I can't use his name too much, really. But if I could have cloned him, that's how God feels about Jesus. He wants to replicate him over and over and over again. They tell us that in this generation alone, there are about 1 billion people on planet Earth that are kin to God through Christ. This generation alone, that's how much he loves Jesus. Wow. From eternity past, they're looking each other in the face. And the love is so deep between them, as Bishop Sheen said, it's a sigh. That's the Holy Spirit. He's, in one way, he's the love between the Father and the Son. They look at each other, all they can say is, wow. Isn't that something? Isn't that giving your goosebumps today? We were not that before we came to Christ, but now we're different. We're just like Jesus. Even though we started out so bad, Titus 3:3, look at how good we wound up. All because of one word. You know what the word is? But. Allah. But. Allah. But, even though we were that, but when the kindness and love of God to man was manifested. Watch it. What on earth are we doing? Not through the works, the ones which we practiced, but rather according to his mercy he saved us. You get it? That's the horse before the cart. That's the way it's supposed to be. He saves us by his grace and his mercy, And then we devote ourselves to doing things that help people out. We help others with our words and with our deeds. Bring them to the Lord. We don't seduce them to spending their life with a counterfeit. But we give them the real deal. Amen? But when the kindness of, and love of God to man was manifested. You know that phrase, love of God to man? You know that's all one word in the text. The love of God to man. That's one word. You know what the word is? You'll know a little Greek, and his name isn't Jimmy. You'll know a little Greek now. That one word that translates love of God to man is philanthropia. Does that sound familiar? Philanthropia. What is a philanthropist? It's a rich dude that gives stuff to people, expecting nothing in return. The first part of that word is from philos, which means love, but it's not the highest kind of love we usually hear about among other Christians, agape. The agape love that is concerned with the object of its affection, not any interaction. This is not that. God doesn't just love you and me and all of lost humanity because he wants to help us and bring us to himself in faith and bring us into the family of God and make us into replications of Jesus. That's not the only way he loves us. He wants to be our friend. Philos is mateship, they would say, down under or across the pond. Your buddy, he's my buddy, he's my friend, he's my mate. That's the love of God, and it's free. Philanthropia, can you imagine that? He sees you, he sees me. Oh, man, let me help you. You didn't know he was Southern. God's Southern, Eastern, Northern. Let me help you. I got to do something to wake you guys up. I'm putting myself to sleep. Isn't that something? This is God's nature. He doesn't just love us as God. He loves us as man. Why? Because in the divine nature, there is now a God-man. Don't ask me to explain this to you. Don't ask anybody that claims to know the Bible a little bit to explain it, because nobody can. When Jesus became man, there was a change in the Godhead. I say it reverently, but it's a fact. Jesus took on himself a human nature. He was not 50-50, a demigod like the Greek myths of Hercules and so on. No, no. He was not 50-50, half human, half divine. He was fully human, fully divine, two natures in one person with no third nature thereby formed. The God-man. So by his becoming fully man, he took humanity up into the Godhead with him. Figure that one out. You can't. Any and every blessing we have is because of the incarnation, because Jesus took on himself our human nature. And humanity was brought up into fellowship with the Godhead, and that will never change. You say, well, that was just for 33 and a half years. No, that was for eternity. Something happened to the Godhead 2,000 years ago that will never be changed. How in the world is that possible? Because of God's philanthropia. I got it. You need it. Come and get it. All you got to do is RSVP. Sign me up. Deal me in. Isn't that beautiful? That's God's nature, to be a father, a lover, and a giver. For God so loved the world, that's agape, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have life everlasting in quality. We were doing works of righteousness, you and I, but they were ours and not his. How many of you understand? Didn't count. Didn't count. Why? What if I try real hard? Why is he so difficult to please? Because his law and his nature demand perfection. The half-brother of Jesus, James, who wrote us the letter that bears his name, said, if you keep the whole law and offend in one point, you're guilty of? That's just the way it is. If you and I try to get up the road to eternal life down there someplace through doing lots of good things like inviting people to movies and whatever we can work up to fill the church house, it's not going to work. Why? Because we're imperfect beings doing imperfect works, because we're motivated by the wrong spirit, and they don't count. They're dead in God's mind. The only good works he accepts are the works of perfection, and only one person performed those. His name is Jesus. Carnal religious people never get this concept, and they despise people like you and me who do. Luther, when he recovered this truth of the Bible, he suffered the torments of hell. He would get so depressed from relentless attacks on him in all different ways. One time he was 5 days in his room, wouldn't come out. 5 days. All they could hear was a word in German that said attack. He would scream that. He would yell that German word that meant attack. God only knows what was happening. He finally got to the place where, according to what I've read, he would wake up in the middle of the night sometime, look down the bottom of his bed, and there was Satan. He finally got to the place where he would look and see him and say, oh, it's just you, and go to bed. But he went through the torments of hell. Why? This is the crux of God's redemption plan for man. Grace through faith. Amen? How did this take place? Through the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit. Did you notice not one word is spoken about water there? It's a shame that even today some Protestants who should know better are once again depending on water baptism for their salvation. They wear their baptism like a flag. You talk to people from some denominations, within 5 minutes, they're talking about water baptism. They want to know if you were, when you were, how you were. And that's not enough. They want to know what words were said over you. What were you thinking when it happened? Where was your faith? Says not one word about water. It's got nothing to do with water. In John's Gospel, chapter 7, Jesus Christ himself tells us what the water is about. The water is the Holy Spirit. If any man is thirsty, let him come unto me and drink. He that believes on me, out of his innermost being will gush what? Rivers of living water. But this, everybody say this. He spake concerning the Spirit. The word this in the text refers to water and Holy Spirit. But this water, he spoke concerning the Spirit. The Spirit of God is the water. He's the one that washes us, not some baptismal font. How many people have gone in the tank, a dry sinner, and come up a wet one? What's so bad about that? They claim that's their salvation. What a surprise they're in for when they leave this life. It's like leaning on a reed. It'll break and pierce your hand. I was baptized, so what? You can be married without ever buying a wedding ring. You can also wear a wedding ring without being married. Which one do you want? It gets better. Which Holy Spirit he poured out upon us through Jesus Christ our Savior. Think about this. The same Holy Spirit who cleansed us inside, who washed out the wrong spirit that used to motivate us and put within us the right nature, the divine nature of God, that same Holy Spirit who washed us and renewed us and gave us the nature of Christ within, that same Holy Spirit was poured out upon us by our baptizer in the Holy Spirit, the Lord Jesus. Why? To give you and to give me and to give every believer supernatural power to witness, to worship, to do the works of God. Supernatural. Why do some churches get so big? Because they're doing things that people can do. People can do all kinds of programs. You can wash cars. You can give away water. You can clean people's houses. You can do all that stuff as an unsaved person. Why are they doing that? Because they don't have access to the supernatural. They can't cast out devils or heal the sick, or raise the dead, or influence weather. They can't cause tumors to disappear. They can't bring sight to the blind or make the deaf hear. They can't lengthen legs. They can't put new bones in backs. They can't grow new hair or new heart tissue or lung tissue. They can't do that. So what do? They do what the only thing they can do. What other businessmen do and local organizations that have nothing to do with Christianity. Why? They can do that. They can show movies. They can have clubs, build house, whatever, call it mission work. But they can't do this. This takes an experience. Let's go back to the beginning. Since unlike so many religious folks, you and I are not spiritual zombies, what are we doing? What on earth are we doing? Hopefully ignoring the seduction of the counterfeit. Why don't you come in? Watch the film. Batter eyes, you know. Why don't you come watch the film? Join us. Sure, it's about zombies, but there's a message in there somewhere. It's not offensive. Come on in. Look, place is jammed. Chock-a-block, come on. Pass, hard pass. Hard pass. We're ignoring the seduction of the counterfeit. What are we doing instead? Sharing God's love with those around us in words and in works. Had somebody come up last week, blessed my socks off. That's why I was glad I had long pants. They disappeared. I said, what's up with you? What's going on? Oh, nothing. I just wanted to pray for you. Is that okay? What? I just wanted to pray for you. Is that all right? And that person prayed a prayer. They would have no way of knowing what's going on in my life. That was exactly what I needed prayer about. Something that I've been seeking for quite a long while, especially the last little while. And I thought, what is that? That's a word from a higher place. You don't get that out of a book. That came from heaven. Through a person, through what they said. We do that with our words and we do that with our works. Amen? We do lay hands on the sick. We do cast out devils. We do let God use us in supernatural signs, wonders, and miracles. And it does make a difference. Amen? What on earth are we doing? Anything the Lord leads us to. Not because we have to, but because we want to and get to. Because everything's right between us and God. And because of that, we're just trying to figure out a way to best be of service to mankind. And what we say and what we do to help the Father in his gathering together of the elect all over planet Earth to see his Son replicated again and again and again and again through even our feeble efforts. Good question for us today, amen, especially in the light of so much counterfeit in organized Christianity. What on earth are we, God's true church, doing? Father, thank you today for this reminder, course correction, and wake-up call. We hear so many voices. They're pounding at us morning, noon, and night. To do this, to buy that, to be the other. We hear so many invitations to go to so many different church groups and religious organizations. And so many, too many, are just natural and fleshly. They're just counterfeits. They're just zombie-like. They look alive, but they're not. They don't meet the need of the heart. They don't change things for eternity. They don't line up with the results we find in your word. Help us today, Lord, to refuse the seduction of the slick, of the glitz, the glamour, of the counterfeit. Help us, Lord, to spend a lot of time with the truth. Thank you for the ability you gave us to RSVP your invitation. Thanks for giving us life now. Thanks for giving our bodies life later. Thanks for giving us opportunities in the meantime to share what we've received as a gift with others through what we say and what we do. Bless us as we come around the table this morning. Again, thank you for the true rather than the counterfeit. Thank you for delivering us from rite and rote and ritual. Thank you for allowing us, Lord, to come around your miracle table where at one and the same time we can dine on bread and cup and also on the risen and glorified flesh and blood of Jesus in with and under these emblems. Jesus, bless those who are sowing into the full gospel. Bless those, Lord, in this fellowship who pray and attend and support and serve. Bless those who are friends of this fellowship, who pray for us, many who support, who stand with us, who have the inclination to partner with apostolic ministry that is doing something significant in many countries of the world. Let the harvest, Lord, come where they need it most 1,000 times over. In Jesus' name, we give you praise this morning for victory in Jesus. Amen.
to you we are an offering. Lord, use our voices. Lord, use our hands. Lord, use our lives. They are lost. We are an offering. All that we have, all that we are, all that we hope to be, we give to you. We give to you. We lift our voices. We lift our hands. We lift our lives up to you. We are an offering. We are an offering.
There's more here than meets the eye. Amen. We know Pastor just wrote a book about it. I've taught on it, studied it, and yet I still feel like there's more. There's more to come. Praying about a dream I had within the last week or two, I think still there's still more God wants to show us, just like the rest of his truth. He's always opening our eyes to more. And well, this is a powerful memorial that he's given us. So amazing. And he took bread and gave thanks. And he broke it and he gave to them, saying, "This is my body, which is being given for you. Do this in memory of me." And in the same way, he took the cup after the supper, saying to them, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you."
If you need prayer this morning, we're glad to join our faith with yours, to have God meet your need as he has done for so many years. There's coffee there outside for time of fellowship. Praise God, praise God, praise God, praise God, praise God, praise God, praise God. Father, I want to thank you today for all you've made possible for us as a fellowship. All the different things you've allowed us to do, Lord, all the technology over the years you've allowed us to use. We thank you for music. We thank you for Christian films. We thank you for movies that have been such a blessing to people in our fellowship. Thanks for reminding us today, Lord. It's not the method, it's the motivation. Lord, help us always to minister in whatever we use as an outflow, an overflow of a new life already within us. Lord, help us to be winsome and attractive to other people so that they are moved to investigate the faith that we have. Forgive us if we've been unruly or pushy or bombastic. We don't see this in the ministry of Jesus. We don't see this in the ministry of the early church, intruding into people's personal space, bombarding, being rude and brash. We see them ministering at places of prayer and in synagogues where the people were looking. Father God, thank you for allowing us to speak a word in season to people that you've placed us in the midst of who are in need of a word from heaven. Let us be wise as serpents, harmless as doves. Let the law of kindness always be on our tongue. Let us, Lord, 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 be attractive and winsome for the kingdom. Continue, Father, to use everything you've placed within our hands, and we say thank you in advance for new technology, new things you're going to lead us into. We say welcome to new people that you've told us are coming on board our fellowship. Thanks for that whole block of people from whatever church that is perhaps closing or moving. Thank you for that. Thank you for the steady stream of new people on Wednesdays. Thank you, Lord, for the full church house on Sunday morning that 10 or 11 of your people have all had the same dream regarding. Thanks, Lord, for being with us in good times and bad and abundance. And when we lacked, thank you for remaining Jesus Christ the same, yesterday, today, and forever. Thank you that your name is Yahweh, the Lord who changes not. Bless your people today, Father, and make us a blessing. Yahweh bless you and protect you. Yahweh make his face shine on you, be gracious, merciful, and beneficent toward you. Yahweh lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his shalom. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Thanks for coming along. See you Wednesday. We'll start thinking about miracle money.